Good morning, friends. Today we are introducing Mr. Amit Trivedi. We need not introduce him. Everybody in the world know him. On behalf of Krishnu Academy, I invite you and I welcome you, sir, for our today's special Sunday session. He's an author, speaker, blogger, trainer, and now Zoomer. More than 26 years, he is having a professional experience in the capital market. And as a trainer, he has trained, I repeat, my dear friends, hear clearly, he has trained more than 82,000 people in India and abroad. He has done 1,286 workshops for CFPs, mutual fund distributors, investors, and regulator. Very, very important. He has done in 130 locations across India. And he has written article in Times of India, Business Standard, Outlook Money, Mumbai Samachar, Midday in Gujarati, moneycontrol.com, morningstar.in, bloomberg.com. He has published 715 articles. Amazing, sir. Hats off to you. And he had written 4 books, which I have read as 2 books. The fantastic 2 books, which he has, his background shows. The third book, I think it is in Hindi, I think I have missed it. But amazing books. Even simple language, my dear friends, if you have not bought this book of Roller Coaster, don't miss it. You must read it. Must read book, at, especially at this scenario. Everybody must read this book. It's available at Amazon. And he is having his own website, amittrivedi.in, www.amittrivedi.in. Simple, no complication. He keeps saying everything simple, no complication at all with him. He has done extensive workshop in investor awareness education along with SEBI, NISM and various AMC. He involved in various projects with NISM, including development of certification program for intermediaries. And thank you for your time today, sir, to take a succession planning for IFAs. Very, very important chapter which Mr. Amit Trivedi is going to take for us. And the stage is yours, sir. Welcome again to Krishnu Academy's
YouTube channel. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And my pleasure to be here talking to all of you today. Mr. Ramesh Bhatt is normally very lavish in the introduction. So I once again thank him for this lovely introduction. Thank you very much, sir. The topic succession planning for IFAs is something that many have intuitively considered, but a large part of distribution fraternity has not paid enough attention to this topic. Now, this is succession planning for one's own business. Many IFAs that I know across the country have helped their clients do succession planning when it comes to their money, their insurance policies, bank accounts, etc., etc. But while helping clients do the succession planning, writing wills, checking the nominations, whether they are in order or not, one thing which is missed out is many IFAs have not thought about what will happen to their business. This is where some amount of thinking is required, some amount of planning is required. And that's why this session will talk about a few things. Essentially, the whole session is divided into 4 big questions. Why succession planning is required? What exactly do we mean by succession planning? How does one do it? And when does one start? We'll try and answer these questions over the next 40 minutes, and let's look at an objective that after this session, a very large number of IFAs start thinking about this topic very, very seriously and take a few steps forward in the direction of doing some amount of proper succession planning. So that is linked to the first question: why succession planning is important. And it is very, very simple. IFAs that I know, many of them are single person operations, but many are the main bread earners, if not the sole bread earners for their family. And from that point of view, the IFAs, you owe it to your family that whatever assets you gathered with your clients, the trail earning that's coming out of that, that also should go to someone. Similarly, you also owe it to your employees, people you employed in the business in various capacities. There are larger IFA organizations where, they have larger teams and sometimes branches also. At the same time, there are very small outfits where there could be one or two employees also. Whatever the size, but you also owe it to your employees. And apart from these two, the biggest constituency in your business is the clients that you are serving. So you see, in many conversations I've had with some of the IFAs, their clients have started asking this question to them. I'm very comfortable with you, Mr. So-and-so or Miss So-and-so, but in case something happens to you, who will take care of my personal finances? Who will take care of my investments? And that's where a few IFAs were so shaken that they really started moving in this direction. This is the biggest why. Your clients need continuity. The habits that you formed as far as your clients are concerned, depending on you for various questions, various help in financial matters, that needs to be continued. Unlike many other businesses, when I say many other businesses, it also includes my business of delivering training programs or writing content, where if something happens to me, at worst, what will happen? The next training program will not happen. Beyond that, nobody loses much. A new trainer will come up from anywhere, and the participants would continue to get good guidance. And there are a very large number of knowledgeable, expert, experienced trainers in the market. But when something happens to an IFA, IFA is helping a client live a financially fulfilling life. And that's where the relationship is long-term, and that continuity must be maintained. This is the big why. You owe it to your clients, your family, and your employees. And if that's the case, who should the business be passed on to? Now, while I'm saying this about something happens to you, it is not necessary. One day you may also feel that you want to take a break from the business. You want to retire. No retirement age is prescribed in this business. I also met somebody a few years back, and God willing, if the person is alive, I guess he should have crossed the century by now. I had met him in Trivandrum in 2011 or 12. He had come to attend one of the training programs, and I just happened to go to him during the break time, and he said, "Can you guess my age?" And I tried to guess something. He said, "I'm 93 years old." Now, this was 2011 or 12. 93 year old. So this business has no retirement age. He was passionately working for the well-being of his clients. But there are also a few who may say 70 years is good enough. I have worked for a pretty long period, but now I want to take a break. I also met somebody who at 75 wanted to continue working, but then the children is probably not the right word, but this IFS son said, "Papa, you worked all your life. Now at least take a break and spend time with us." I mean, the father was in India and the son was in the United States. So the son said, Papa, now, why don't you come and join us here and stay with us? We also want to benefit out of your, wisdom. We want to be with, spend time with you. And that's another reason why people want to take retirement. Whatever be the reason, their business must be passed on to somebody. And that somebody could be among these four. So, and we've got a live example. Mr. Ramesh Bhatt has already prepared the next generation. Apurva is doing a phenomenal job. So your children can take over. Or it could be a partner if you started as a partnership firm. And even if you not started as a partnership firm, there are a few examples where partners have joined in at a later stage. So a senior person takes a younger partner. And when I say younger, it's only in terms of the biological age. So a younger person joins so that when the senior person wants to retire, the business is continued by the junior partner who is joined later. That's another option available with people. The third, there are organizations where the employees are groomed in such a manner. The second line is ready that they can take over. And the current owner, the IFA, continues to remain the owner and the management takes over. So this gives a professional set to the whole business. Or it could be an outsider who takes over. Now, by outsider, I don't mean that you always get somebody from outside to run the business. You can also consider, can this business be sold to somebody? Is there a buyer available? There are multiple options there. And primarily, these four, which can help you in continuing of your business. Now, for that purpose, we also need to see what is the structure of this business, the way it is structured. And I only mentioned three. There could be multiple ways. I mean, I've not mentioned something like one-person company or LLP, etc. Because broadly, it is either sole proprietorship or partnership or a company. You can do the sub classification further. But broadly speaking, a sole proprietorship is something where transferring the ownership. Well, you can't actually transfer the ownership of a proprietorship, right? So what you can do is you can transfer the assets, the AUM, to somebody else. But transferring the insurance business, insurance agency in somebody's name is not possible. So you've got to think about what are the possibilities there. A partnership that way becomes a relatively easier idea. But again, getting an insurance agency in the name of a partnership is not as easy as getting it in a sole proprietorship. But in a mutual fund distributorship, ARN, getting it in the name of a partnership or a sole proprietorship or a company also is very, very easy. So that continuity becomes very easy in a partnership and company structure, but not so in a sole proprietorship. AMFI has allowed a provision wherein you can appoint a nominee who receives trail. But that nomination has a small issue. Nomination is not transfer of assets in another person's code. Which means, so long as that those assets remain under that code, this person continues to get the trail. Now imagine, and then while AMFI has done a phenomenal job in allowing this nomination, but just imagine that if an IFA nominates his son or daughter, and the son or daughter is not interested or not inclined to be an IFA and wants to pursue some other career, and hence does not pass the NISM exam, the required NISM 5A exam. What happens in that case is any new assets coming under the old ARN and there is no trail income. So let's say if an SIP is running, what do you do? As the redemptions come, the assets keep depleting. So that poses a small challenge. Now, imagine another scenario wherein the son or daughter is interested in getting into this business. Sir, I have a small issue with the internet bandwidth, so I'm just switching over to my phone's hotspot. I'm sorry for this interruption. The son or daughter is interested in becoming an IFA and ticks in ARN. Because this earlier ARN was in the name of the father or the mother, in a proprietorship way or individual category, and the son or daughter's ARN is also in an individual category, which means two ARNs are different. Now, how do you transfer AUM from here to this? So these are some small challenges that we need to figure out, and that's why some amount of preparation is required. This is where setting a structure, be it a partnership or a company, may be a better idea. In case of a company, straight away, only the shareholding needs to be changed. All you need is one person should be NISM exam certified, the key person, and the business continues so long as there is a person who has a valid NISM certification and the ARN is renewed, EUIN is renewed. So that process is not a problem. So please consider, if you are having your ARN in an individual name or your proprietorship name, should you look at forming a partnership or should you look at forming a company? I'll leave it to you because I'm not an expert on how to form a company, etc. Mr. Ramesh Bhatt is an expert and he has conducted a few sessions on this subject also. You can take guidance from him, or maybe some sessions are already available. But these are the thoughts as far as continuation of the business is concerned. Okay, so we have just discussed broadly these three. How do you transfer the sole proprietorship? Very, very difficult. Partnership, new partner enters and old partner exits. That way it becomes relatively smooth, and the two partners can continue for a reasonably long period also. Now, this partnership also can be either the normal partnership that we have, or it could be a limited liability partnership, which is LLP. So that's possible. Or in case of a company, the shareholding is changed. So that's quite possible. And that becomes quite smooth. We'll come back to these two structures sometime later once again, because these two structures offer some very interesting options for the person who's quitting and the person who takes over. Both these get some interesting options, and those arrangements would be beneficial for the person who's taking over the business, the person who's handing over the business, as well as the clients of the business. And that's where how do you transfer is one part, and at what price is the other part. Now, somebody may wonder, why do I bother about valuation if I'm transferring the ownership to my children? Your choice. But let's say if I've got two children, and if anyway I'm bequeathing some part of my assets to one of my child, shouldn't the other also get a fair share? So when I'm handing over a business, which is an earning asset, to one child, the other child should not feel that the first one got a bigger share and I got a smaller share. And from that point of view, if there is a fair valuation done, that would always help. So what is a fair valuation and how do you look at it? First of all, a lot of times people ask this question, what percentage of AUM should be the valuation? Well, difficult. This is not the right approach. It is like price to earning ratio. In case of a stock, price to earning ratio is the result based on the current market price and the earning per share of the company. Price to earning ratio cannot be the starting point that I want to buy a stock at PE of this. No, if I buy the stock at this price, then I'm buying at this PE. So similarly, in this case also, the valuation
happens or a deal happens of buy and sell, and then you say, okay, it happened at so and so percentage of the AUM, and exactly in similar way, it is a multiple of income. Now, multiple of income is marginally a better approach than percentage of AUM, simply because what is the AUM breakup? It is easy for many to assume that larger part of the AUM is equity. Well, that may not be the case. In some cases, larger part of the AUM could be fixed income funds. Or there could be an IFS business where there is a mutual fund business and also there is insurance business. There could also be an IFS business where, apart from mutual funds, one is also selling fixed deposits of various companies. You keep looking at multiple types of business, and income is a better way to look at the business than the assets under management. Assets under management is a good idea only if entire business is only mutual fund business. The third question, which often a lot of people ask, and this is precisely at the time of selling to somebody else. So if I have to sell my business to somebody else, what should be the valuation? Now, something that I have created, I mean, I've worked really, really hard. I've slogged. I put my blood and sweat. I put all my talents, all my skills, my relationships also, okay, in creating this business. And for that, am I getting only so much? Now, when a few deals happened, I happened to be part of a few deals between some firms or IFAs, when one person was selling to somebody else, then this question came up. So my humble submission to everybody is, valuation of business is not a function of your blood, sweat and tears. How much blood and sweat or tears you've lost, the business valuation does not give any regard to that part. Just imagine that a farmer has put some seeds into the soil and then he wants to go and sell the crop. The farmer will not be paid on the basis of how many seeds he has planted. He would be paid on the basis of the crop that comes out. Now, one may say that, yeah, the quality of seeds that you put, the using the same terms, blood, sweat and tears that you put in tilling the farm, sowing the whole crop, entire thing is the input part, but nobody pays anything for the input. People would pay only for the output. So be careful about this part. And that's why what we need to do is, yes, we need to put blood, sweat and tears. We need to do that. But don't be emotional about this part. I worked so hard. Okay, that's okay. It was required. And I mean, I can say that I've got humongous respect for a lot of IFAs across the country who've really done a wonderful job in creating the environment where so many investors have benefited out of, investing their money in the right manner. And I'm not even saying that it is only mutual funds. I'm saying across the board, it was the IFA who's really gone from door to door, got people to look at various investments, handheld them, taken care of their feelings and emotions, and the clients have benefited out of it. So huge respect for this blood, sweat that you put in the business, but still, valuation is not a function of that. And let's be very, very carefully aware of this part. Then if that's the case, what does the valuation depend on? The valuation of the business is nothing but a function of the quality and sustainability of cash flow coming from the business. I'm saying cash flow, it is not just income. It is income minus the expenses. So I'm not getting into the technical formula, but technically the term that they use is called the free cash flow. This free cash flow accounts for what is the kind of income that you can get against what are the expenses that you are incurring. And of course, adjusted for a lot of other stuff. Without going into the technical definition, even if I only look at the income, then how much income can this business generate? And in case of a mutual fund distributor, the income that you generate is what? Trail. In case of insurance business, the income that you generate is what? A percentage commission on the amount of premium that the client pays. So that's the income. The good part in both these businesses, insurance and mutual fund, is so long as the assets remain invested or so long as the premium are paid, the income is generated. So to a great extent, this business has a better sustainability of income. What does this quality and sustainability of cash flow depend on? And there are a few things. Number one, size of the asset. Larger the AUM, more or better is the sustainability, because beyond a point, and remember, the cash flow that we talked about is net of expenses. If the assets are significantly large, then compared to the expenses, you got a bigger buffer. But otherwise, if the assets are small, then compared to the expenses, the buffer is very small. And if the asset size falls, and it can fall due to market crash also recently in the last couple of months, that's precisely what we've seen. I mean, January to now, the Sensex is down by roughly 25%. Of course, the income goes for a toss in such case. Trail comes down. But 25% reduction in income is a problem when the expenses are 75 or 80% of the pre-crash income. So if I was earlier earning 100 rupees and my expenses were 80, my net cash flow was 20. If the assets fall by 25%, my income, which is 100, also falls to 75. Now my income is 75, but my expenses don't fall because of the market crash. So I am net negative. And that way, the sustainability of the cash flow, suddenly a profit-making business becomes loss-making. That's where asset size matters. And it does not mean that small AUM is a problem and large AUM is not a problem. No, it is in relation to the expenses incurred. So if a very large AUM business incurs extraordinarily large expense, that quality is poor. And compared to that, if a small IFA is earning or is having smaller AUM, let's say a 15 or 20 crore AUM also, but the cost management is brilliant, then you are better. I mean, then you are actually far better. Having said that, when it comes to succession planning, if you are giving it to your children, your employees, or your partner, small AUM is okay. But if you want to sell it to somebody, a lot of people may not want to touch if the AUM is too small. So this has nothing to do with the expense structure. It is simply the size of the AUM, and somebody may say, I'm not interested. The client mix. Now, this is about, do you have retail clients, HNI clients, or corporate clients? Do you have younger clients or old clients? Various things. And of course, number of clients that you have, smaller the number of clients, your business's cash flow is not very sustainable. So let's say I've come across a few cases where there's an IFA that I met a few years back. Roughly 150 clients that he was managing, predominantly HNIs. Now, And then the AUM at, in those days was around 80 crores. Yes, these are the initial inputs that I got from this IFA. Now, if you look at this business, today, of course, the AUM has grown significantly from that level. But 80 crore AUM, 150 clients, and predominantly HNIs. So you may say, yeah, 150 HNIs? It's a good business for a single person operation. But when you dig deeper, you realize that the largest client accounted for 40% of the AUM. And if you add the next three clients, which means top four out of 150 clients, top four clients accounted for 75% of the AUM. Now imagine what happens if one of these four decides to go. The entire business may collapse. That's vulnerable. So when you look at client mix, a client mix should be such where, and in mutual fund portfolios also, we prefer portfolios which are more diversified across various assets, various securities. In case of your client mix also, the same thing is better and it is considered superior. The third is, how deep is the client relationship and client engagement? Now, let's look at two parts of this. And because we are looking at valuation, the first part of valuation is when you are giving it to your own children or your own employees, for example, and you want to assign some value to it because it's a commercial transaction, you're transferring an asset. That's the second part, you're selling it to an outsider. Whichever way you want to look at it, the client relationships and engagement from the perspective of transfer of ownership, which means the IFA no longer continues to remain in the business. From that point of view, client relationships and engagement better be automated, or as a process, it should be independent of the IFA. Here is a question to consider to evaluate: how much is your business dependent on you as an individual? Imagine that the lockdown is over and the world comes back to the normal of 2019 and foreign travel starts. And assume that you want to take an off and go for a 3-month vacation to Europe. 3 months, you want to switch off your phone and want to go to Europe. In how many cases can the business function that way? When I asked this question in training programs, a lot of people have said, 3 months, nobody goes, don't even bother about it. I said, no problems, don't go for 3 months. Now imagine that you are out for 1 week, 7 days. 7 days, yeah, I do take that kind of vacation, but my phone is always on. I said, okay, no problems. Can you keep your phone switched off for 48 hours? And that's a disaster in the minds of a lot of people. When you are exiting a business, handing it over to somebody else, the quality of relationship, that personal touch will go away, of course, but at least the mechanical part, scheduled meetings, regular interaction, are you meeting all the clients or not? These things must be part of a process. And if that happens, then the quality and sustainability of earning goes up. Today morning, I was actually reading a write-up somewhere, and it says that in case of clients where the IFA is, this is America, okay, so a US-based report, not India, but in case where the advisor meets the client 4 times in a year versus in cases where advisor meets once a year. Okay, four meetings a year versus one meeting a year, and the clients who are met 4 times, they are far, far more happy and satisfied, and they feel that they are getting better value out of the relation with the advisor. Tell me, if the client carries this kind of a feeling that I'm getting better value from my advisor, I'm satisfied, I'm happy with my advisor, obviously one would want to stay longer with that advisor. And in this case, let's say instead of advisor, let's call it advisory firm. Asset mix, how much is in equity, how much in debt, how much in liquid matters, right? And all of you know that. So I don't really want to go into details, but that asset mix also matters. Not only from the point of percentage commission, but also from the point of view of the volatility of the AUM, equity assets, the trail is higher than liquid. But liquid, the AUM is much more stable, and to that extent, the trail is also more stable. Equity, the trail is highly volatile. So that asset mix also matters. And again, I'm not saying that because liquid trail is more stable, you go for liquid. No, you need both. You need defensive liquid portfolio, and you need attacking aggressive equity portfolio, because equity would give growth to your business income also. Liquid would give stability to your business income also. Fifth point, is your business known by you and only you, or is it known by somebody, I mean, as a firm? So Mr. Ramesh Bhatt and Aniram, in the minds of us industry people, both are same. But the client says, okay, somebody's come from Aniram or somebody's come from Mr. Ramesh Bhatt's office. So while the brand name continues, but somebody has come, takes care of the relationship or takes care of the client requirements. So the brand image, the value proposition that you offer, and the expertise. If the expertise is perceived to be only you, then again transfer would pose some challenges. Anyway, there is a way out there, but it poses some challenges. Individual expertise versus firm level expertise, and valuation becomes better if the expertise is firm level. If your staff has stayed longer with you, and the engagement with the clients is at the staff level, then again the sustainability of income goes up. And lastly, whatever the size of your business, is your client acquisition machinery on? Whether you like it or not, some clients would leave you and go away. And there could be multiple reasons. A simple reason could be, which is something in nobody's hand, death. Will the next generation stay with you? Not sure. In a lot of cases, the new generation, next generation has come to the advisor. In a lot of cases, new generation has tried to find a new advisor. And currently, as we speak, many clients have invested through the advisors, but their next generation is going to the technology-oriented platforms. But these are the realities of life. So some certain things that we need to keep in mind, that whatever the situation, your client acquisition machinery should be on. And that again is not only referrals. Okay, referrals is a very powerful source of getting new clients. But if it is only a reference because of you, then the business is not acquiring clients. You are acquiring clients. So consider that difference. So long as possible, it is the business that should keep getting clients. If it is sold to somebody, what should you get? part payment or full payment, or the full payment over a period of time, or full payment upfront is what I meant by part payment. If it is spread over a period, then over what period should it be spread? And should it be in cash or kind? So if you're transferring it to your family members, then it is not in cash, it is kind. If you're transferring it to your employees, then also it could be in kind. So let's say a scenario where, and this is something that we learned from some of the multinational firms, and then later on in the technology sector and now in the startup sector, a lot of key employees are given stock options. Can you think of that when you hire key management people in your firm? They join you as a minority partner. So let's say if I am 55 years old and I decide to work till 65, I've got 10 years to work. I start looking for capable and competent people who are in their 30s or maybe even 40s at best. And when I take them on, I would say, okay, you join as a 5% owner, which means my share is 95, yours is 5. And then based on performance, every year I keep increasing the share of this person by a few, you know, percentages. So that from 55 to 65, we have arrived at a situation where some part of the, or a larger part of the ownership is now with that partner, and I become a minority partner in this business, and I've gradually withdrawn myself. And this is precisely where the individual expertise can be easily transferred in the minds of the client that, okay, yeah, so far X person was coming in meeting me, now a Y person also is somebody whom I've been meeting for now 3 years, 5 years, 7 years, whatever. And then it becomes easy transition, because this period, over what period, is extremely important. This is not a switch. This is a relationship. Building relationship takes years. So you can't just switch off and say, today onwards I'm out, today onwards this person is in, so now he's your relationship manager. That happens in banks, that happens in various companies. Your relationship manager changes. I mean, the bank with which I have an account, once every 2 to 3 years, somebody calls up an unknown number and says, sir, I'm so and so, I'm your new relationship manager. I said, what happened to the old one? So he's got promoted, or he got transferred to another branch, or he's quit the bank. Oh, hello. This cannot be a relationship. If it is relationship, you do gradually introduce somebody and transfer the ownership, transfer the relationship over a period of time. This is not a switch. Relationship takes time. And that's where, even if you are selling the firm to somebody else, it always pays to stay with the firm over a certain period. And that's why, instead of full payment, you may actually ask for part payment and slowly and gradually withdraw. And by the time you withdraw, you would have received the entire payment. These are methods and mechanisms of transferring ownership. Need any mutual funds, a scheme information document. One thing that you always see is the riskometer. And the same riskometer is the happiness meter that you see here. Whatever actions you take, whatever decisions you take, this is not exactly for, actually for you. You are one of the beneficiaries, but ultimately it is the clients who should be on the green side. If you decide to quit, the client should be not disturbed, because the client knows, yes, I respect your decision. You served me for so long, you've been with me for so long, and now you are handing my portfolio to another competent person. So let's look at the qualities of a few qualities of good successor. And I've just said TAP, T-A-P. What is T? T, this business is a trust-based business. So whoever you are transferring the business to, be it your family member, be it your employee, be it your partner that you take, or somebody you are selling to, check on these two: integrity and competence. Competence is the ability to do good. Integrity is the willingness to do good. Both are important, because trust is made up of these two things. What exactly is trust? Trust means I'm putting my lifelong saving in your hands, and what am I getting in return? All I'm getting is a hope that over a period of time, this wealth will grow. So I have to know for sure that, number one, you are not misguiding me, and that's where integrity comes in. And number two, I know that you are capable of helping me achieve my goals, and that capability comes from competence. So trust-based business, so keep integrity and confidence in mind. Second, A is adaptability to change. What can I say about change? Is there anybody who had thought in early March that we would be sitting at home for 2 months, completely locked down? At least I am in Bombay, completely locked down. And many parts of India, things are slowly opening up. We are still under lockdown. 2 months. Not met a friend, not met my family members. Okay, I mean, of course, my wife and kids are with me only, but my parents, my sisters, not met anybody. Change. How do you adapt to that change? And I was talking to Mr. Ramesh Bhatt when we discussed about this session. Had anybody asked me in February, would you be doing webinars? And I would have very comfortably said, and actually that's what I was doing. I was comfortably telling everybody, not my cup of tea, I can't do it. And in last 1 month, actually 35 days, this could be my 20th webinar in 35 days. Adaptability to change. When you identify a successor, how easily and how fast can this person change? And the three broader aspects that I've mentioned are technologically, in terms of changes in products and operations, and any regulatory changes. How fast one can adapt to change. And P, while this is trust-based business and trust is related to people, this is a people business. And when it is people business, technical competence is one part, but emotional competence, and as somebody has beautifully coined this phrase, IQ, intelligence quotient, is required, but emotional quotient or EQ is actually what builds relationships and takes you ahead, because we are social animals. We deal with people and we got to take care of people. And investment is one such area where periodically we are driven by emotions of greed, hope, and fear. In this case, a good IFA comes in, and a good IFA is one who is emotionally more stable than most clients. And because of that stability, you cool down the emotions of the clients, which means in a bear market, you stop clients from redeeming, or you stop the clients from stopping their SIPs unnecessarily. And when there is a red hot investment, you would throw caution. Sir, cool down. Madam, cool down. This may not be the right investment right now. And that's what a highly stable, a person with high emotional quotient can do. And this comes with experience. And because we are talking about succession, I'm assuming that the person who's planning for one's succession has already spent at least a decade in this business. And if you spent a decade in this business or two, then obviously you yourself developed some amount of emotional quotient. Transfer that, guide that successor, coach the successor, and that would help. And of course, when you're getting the new, you also got to take care of the old, not just in terms of business succession, but in terms of clients also. When you acquire new clients, you know, currently the way you are managing business, when you get new clients, you don't forget the old clients, because the old clients you only had bought. But if, let's say, my son comes into business, my son would get his age group clients. But what will happen to my age group clients? He only has to manage those clients. That's why get the new, but also take care of the old. And that's because this is a people's business. If you take care of these clients, I mean, if your successor takes care of clients, then the successor actually gets a far superior value. And the clients are taken care of. When do you start working on your succession plan? So when do you assign a nominee in case of any client? When do you ask your client to write a will? You don't really wait for the client to turn 70 years that now is the time to write a will. When do you do it? Actually, the basic rule of will writing is exactly the same as assigning nomination. The day a savings bank account is opened, the first asset is created. And that is the day when will writing can happen. Succession planning also is very, very similar. The day you start your business, the day you acquire your first client's check, that's the day you can start thinking of succession planning. But as they say, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years back. The next best time is today. So if you've not done succession planning so far, today is the best time to start thinking about it and planning for succession of your business. So I would very, very strongly urge everyone to start thinking of this. I've given some small guidances on what can be done, why it should be done, when it should be done, how it should be done. And with that, I guess you should be able to march ahead on this path. Thank you so much, sir,
for this wonderful opportunity.
That was pleasure hearing you, sir. Especially the valuation, which has given me a big light today on the valuation. Normally people say, boss, valuation, 2%, 3%, 4% of your assets. Normally they do this mistake. But you have put it in a beautiful pointers: asset size, client mix, client relationship and engagement, asset mix, brand image, staff longevity, and client acquisition. These are all awesome points. Awesome points.
Thank you so much.
Everybody
Thank
is you so just much. Like a Bible for valuation in our business now. You have done Thank a so great much. Job. Wonderful thing. Almost you have spent 1 hour with us. I am really thankful on behalf of Krishnu Academy for your wonderful, wonderful and wonderful sessions today, sir. And thanks to you on behalf of Krishnu Academy, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. My pleasure.